And how can we have a kingdom, a society made up by virgins?
I'd like to make an objection.
Yes, sir, please.
Theology says that there was a new plenitude of the grace of God.
Mister, I don't know if we can, just to be careful how we word things so that our followers don't.
Well, it's good that we're speaking with theologians, right?
Oh, not.
Because if the person is called to the married state.
But then there is a very deep link between slavery to Our Lady and her virginity.
Furious, steaming at the head because the priest had spoke about the virginity and chastity.
I think the title for our podcast could maybe be The Battle Cry of Virginity.
Salve Maria, and welcome to Mary Our Queen, the podcast of the Slaves of Our Lady. Once again, we have with us Reverend Father David Ritchie.
Salve Maria.
And Brother Morgan, as usual.
Salve Maria.
So, today, as many of you know already, we are going to be talking about the virginity of Our Lady, to be more precise, theologically exact, the perpetual virginity of Our Lady. Of course, Father, as slaves of Our Lady, anything about anything related to Our Lady is always something very important for all slaves. But then again, in our days, it seems that this dogma, this, this aspect of Our Lady, her chastity, her virginity, her purity, has a greater relevance in the 21st century. Because of the state of the world, do you think so? Do you think that virginity is something very important nowadays, in a certain sense, more than the other aspects of Our Lady? Do you agree with me on this?
Well, of course, we have four Marian dogmas, and it's the second dogma, the perpetual virginity of the Blessed Virgin Mary, was proclaimed in the Council of Lateran Council in 1648, is that correct?
649.
No, not 16.
six, not 16. And of course, it's a privilege. The perpetual virginity is a privilege that has its source in the maternity of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Of course, being Mother of God, God wanted for His own mother that which is the apex, the height. And I think we're going to talk a little bit about that today, how someone could have the greatest dignities that were due to a mother and to a virgin, the Blessed Virgin Mary received from God. And of course, that came from the fact that she is the mother of God. And so, of course, the maternity of Our Lady was proclaimed in the Council of Ephesus.
So, Father, thinking back, then I guess 600 and let's say to another 400, 1,400 exactly, around 1,500, between 1,400, 1,500 years since this dogma has been proclaimed. Of course, Dr. Plinium always says that the church has a certain progress in her doctrine always. No, this is, of course, not only Dr. Plinium, but Dr. Plinium always gives concrete examples explaining how something which is always believed by the church, as time passes, whatever truth we always knew, it has a sort of speaker, it blossoms over time. We start understanding more and more, and the church, in spite of appearances, is always stronger, is always richer, richer in doctrine, richer in insight. So, has something changed since then, do you think, about the perception that we have as Catholics about the virginity of Our Lady?
I think that when we speak about the reign of Mary, it's going to be the kingdom of virginity.
Oh, that's beautiful.
It's going to be the kingdom of virginity. Oh, but then how can we have a kingdom, a society made up by virgins? How is that possible? There's a word which I'm not sure if we can translate it to English, but virginality. Therefore, everything, not only that which is most pure, that which is most upright, righteous, that which is most immaculate, that which is most perfect and and let's say snow-like white, but that which has to do with Our Lady has to do with that which is most perfect in creation. And so I think we have to start off from that. Yes, there's going to be a development in the doctrine and in the understanding of virginity, but of course everything that emanates from the virgin mind of God, because his mind is immaculate. God's mind is perfect. So when we could say that God's mind is virgin, and therefore he had to have the most perfect development that came from his mind, which was his son, Jesus Christ, who is virgin, Christ, virgin, his mother had to be virgin as well. Therefore, in body and soul. But more importantly, in soul. But our Lord, or let's say God, wanted that she be not only virgin in soul, but also in body.
Yeah.
And we have that in the Old Testament. We already have Isaiah in chapter 7. He speaks about that a virgin that would give birth. And, of course, in several other passages in the Gospels, they refer to the virginity of Our Lady.
The virginity, it's beautiful what you said now, Father, because Our Lady's virginity, of course, somebody can be a virgin because he didn't have or she didn't have an opportunity to marry or because of any other circumstance. But then her virginity, like you said, she had a virginity besides the virginity of the body. She had a virginity of her soul.
Spirit.
A spirit, exactly. What is this virginity of the spirit? I mean, virginity of the body is those who never had a relation, which is proper to generate children. But what is this virginity of the soul?
The virginity of the soul, the virginity of the spirit, is the perfect conformity of one's will with God's will. Therefore, when Saint Luke speaks of, and she, after the birth of the child Jesus, she considered, she thought, she pondered on all of what had happened, the words of God, those episodes that had taken place, and she developed upon them in her heart. She was conferring if her heart was in total unity, in total consonance with the will of God. And that's why when she went perfectly, when she was virgin in all of her trials, all of her difficulties, it was because she had the supreme identity of mind and thought, body, soul, spirit with God.
And also, Brother John, the theologians, they tell us that virginity, the virtue of virginity, is divided, has two forms. Has the material form and the spiritual form.
Okay.
Sorry. You have the material aspect of virginity, and you have the formal aspect of virginity, to speak more precisely. And the material aspect exactly is like what you said, like a child who was a virgin.
Had relations before, yeah.
But somebody who is violated, for example, or against their will, they lose the material aspect, but the formal aspect they still have, the virginity of the soul, of the spirit. And of course, Our Lady had the two of them. She had the formal and the material aspect. Of course, we know she made her vow of virginity. The theology discusses if it was if she made an absolute vow or not.
Or a conditional vow.
Or a conditional. And even St. Thomas, who bases himself on something that St. Augustine says that she did not necessarily make an absolute vow.
Okay.
Others say that she did, in fact, make an absolute vow. Ever since her birth, even those who base themselves on St. Thomas. So it's that discussion that exists in theology.
And what we know for sure is that her soul, she was absolutely certain to maintain it virgin always, even though they may have this discussion about but even then, at least conditionally, she wanted to remain a virgin. Her desire was to remain a virgin, in spite of the fact that it went against all the Judaic tradition. Because
exactly. That's why they talk about the absolute, the relative, because of the traditions. But it's clear that she wanted to be a virgin for life. But if some point God revealed, like he did and he has, even so, she
and she said, objected.
Well, what about my virginity?
Exactly.
So she but, had that virginity of...
But what Father said is really impressive, because when you said now that spiritual virginity consists in the total union of the of your own will, of your own soul to God, it's beautiful, because the moment in which God performed the miracle of preserving Ali's virginity while giving her maternity, making her a mother, was the Annunciation. As soon as she gave her consent to God, God performed this miracle of making her a mother and virgin. I mean, before that, she was a virgin like any other young woman is a virgin. In spite of her soul, she had a special desire, etc. But physically, there was nothing extraordinary, because she was a virgin. Like, it became a miracle from the moment that she started being a mother.
Sure.
Now, this miracle took place.
I think that the miracle took place before the descent of the Holy Spirit.
Why?
Because when the descent of the Holy Spirit came about, it's, theology says that there was a new plenitude of the grace of God.
Yeah.
But she already had a plenitude of the grace of God from her conception.
Yes.
And therefore, she received a specific, let's say, if we could call that virginality. She had such an identity with the Spirit of God that although there wasn't a formal descent of the Holy Spirit to her to dwell within her or to dwell on her, she was already totally conformed with the will of God. And that was already a virginity of spirit.
Yeah. No.
But of course, new plenitudes came about along during her life.
But what I was mentioning was the miracle of the virginity of her body, which is the exact moment when she received it. It is when she said, "This is the handmaid, the slave of the Lord," in the original. "This is the slave of the Lord. Be it done to me according to thy word." When she called herself a slave, she demonstrated her maximum conformity with the will of God, so to speak. So when the spiritual virginity received its maximum apex in all history, in all of history, that is the moment when she received the miracle of the physical virginity in her body.
She consecrated the spiritual aspect when she received the bodily aspect.
She received the bodily aspect when when she made a... In fact, if you look about that.
Just, I don't know if we can, just to be careful how we word things so that our followers don't. To say she received a miraculously the virginity. She conceived miraculously and continued being a virgin.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not that
yeah.
she was given a miraculous virginity. In a certain sense, yes.
Yeah, I understand.
But just to...
Just be precise, exactly.
She didn't.
Yeah, because what I wanted to say with that was...
It's good that we're speaking with theologians, right?
Oh, not.
Father David.
Father David, he's probably not much. But I know in the...
Yeah, that is true. It's well mentioned. What I wanted to say there was that her virginity became miraculous from the moment of her conception. Before that, it was a natural virginity.
Exactly.
The miraculous virginity of hers began with the from the moment of her conception, which came from the plenitude of the spiritual virginity, like Father just said, and that's very beautiful. But then again, Father, if you think about it, because this podcast we're having now is for all the slaves of Our Lady. I mean, all Catholics watch it, I'm sure. I hope there are many who watch this today who are not slaves yet, but will be in the future consecrations. But basically, this is meant above all for the slaves of Our Lady, this consecration. Now, this podcast. So now, like I said, it never occurred to me the identity of this Marian dogma with our slavery. Because the slavery of Our Lady produced this. Of course, it produced a maternity as well. It was that was the moment she became a mother. But then there is a very deep link between slavery to Our Lady and her virginity. In fact, I remember a prayer by Dr. Plinium where he prays as a slave of Our Lady to her, and he mentions the following. My mother, it's a prayer he says, he gives it to people who are passing through temptations against chastity, against purity. My mother, thou who didst love virginity so much that when God offered thee the virtue, the offer to you, the possibility of being the mother of God, the highest honor possible for any creature, you, so to speak, objected to it in the name of your virginity.
Alleged
your virginity.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's very beautiful. That's a very beautiful thought.
But even at, exactly, she alleged in order not to stain in any way her desire to maintain that which she had received from God.
Yeah.
And
she loved virginity so much that she denied a greater gift.
She was willing to forfeit being the mother of God in order not to give up that certainty that God wanted for her.
Wow.
And what did God give her in return? She both maternity and virginity.
And when you see, when there are people that have difficulties with Our Lady being perpetually virgin, many times there are people who have a grudge with the option that God could give to someone to inspire. Therefore, the person is actually going against something which is a possibility that God gives to anyone, but wanted to give to his mother. And I even remember a little fact. It was one of our priests, a herald priest, that he spoke in a sermon. He spoke about the virginity of Our Lady and about chastity. And after the Mass, a man, I'm not going to say gentleman, but a man approached him and said, "Father, can I tell you something?" And he said, yes, of course. He said, "Never repeat a sermon like that in your life." And he turned around and walked off, furious, steaming at the head, because the priest had spoke about the virginity and chastity.
It's something which creates a lot of hatred, unfortunately, because there have been saints, there have been revelations who've said that it is one of the sins which takes, the sins against chastity is one of the sins which takes a greater number of people to hell. But then there are two ways to face this when somebody has a weakness. One is to admire the purity of Our Lady, to look at her, to be enchanted with that and strive towards it, in spite of the fact that the person may have faults. The other option is for the person to, so to speak, give up, and that produces hatred. When he thinks that that's so, something so pure that it's not for me. Very often I've seen this, that people who hate us, hate the heralds, sometimes they accuse us, we find in public people who have an instinctive hatred against us is because of this reason, very often, of chastity. When they perceive that a sort of a spiritual cleanliness, but then that spiritual cleanliness is an offer for the person to be clean if he's not. The problem is when the person takes it as something, as you're trying to crush him, but you're not. You're trying to help him become better. But the mere fact that we practice chastity, and not just us, I mean anybody who practices chastity, be it absolute chastity or chastity within matrimony, in this way, when we imitate Our Lady, it creates a hatred in the enemies of the true faith. Just like Our Lady created a hatred in Satan, in spite of the fact that Satan being an angel, the devil being an angel, cannot have sins against the flesh. He's not a virgin either. I mean, his spirit conforms to those sins against chastity. Just like an angel, even though he cannot practice physical purity because he doesn't have anything physical. He's just a spiritual purity. But there's something in an angel which is alike, which goes with physical chastity. Something in the devil which goes with physical impurity. I guess that's one of the reasons that the devil hates Our Lady so much.
Mm-hmm.
Her virginity provokes a lot of hatred.
That's why you could say perfectly well, you could say that pride is the impurity of the spirit, and impurity is the pride of the body.
Yeah, exactly. There are things which go together, isn't it?
Yes.
They
go together.
There are Dr. Lee used to comment about vices and virtues who are sisters. In fact, I heard a sermon recently, very beautiful, where the priest was proclaiming this, preaching about this, that very often the person, when he has a problem with chastity, the solution for him is to try and become more humble. Pray for humility, because when the person has serious problems with humility, when he's full of himself, chastity, the practice of chastity, naturally becomes much more difficult. In fact, for Our Lady, was totally pure. She was absolutely pure forever. But one of the reasons of her purity was her humility. The fact that she was so humble, so empty of herself, that she could be full of God.
There's a very beautiful fact, speaking about when we speak about the Annunciation. And of course, that's why Saint Gabriel is, let's say, he's the archangel of chastity, of purity, or virginity. And of course, that's why he announced to the Blessed Virgin Mary not only that she would be the Mother of God, but she would be Mother and Virgin. And it's interesting because when Blessed Catherine Emerich, when she speaks about what she saw right after the Annunciation, and of course the words, let's say the words, this, behold the servant, the slave of the Lord, be it done to me, be it done to me according to thy word, to your word, to your desire, to your will. When she said that, that was, like, say, the battle cry of virginity. That was the battle cry of virginity, because she was conforming, let it be done according to thy perfect will. Thy will, your will, God, is perfect, so let it be done in me. And that aspect, as you said, made when with both the virginity of spirit and body were totally united. And afterwards, Blessed Catherine Emerich says that she went up into her room, because in the house where she was, where Saint Gabriel appeared to her, she went up to her room and she knelt down. And she had a veil on her, and she knelt down, she started to praying, and she went into ecstasy. At the moment when she went into ecstasy, the child Jesus appeared, of course, mystically appeared to her, and she was able to see that child, which would be the fruit of her womb. And she already had a spiritual joy of how it would be to give birth to the child Jesus, and anticipating the moments of the joy of birth, because it was a reward to her saying yes. And at the same moment when that took place, therefore when the incarnation took place, all of the hell, all of the devils, all of the evil spirits that existed anywhere in the universe were all thrusted into the basement of hell, and there was put a cover over all of the devils, all of the impure spirits. All the spirits were covered, and they were down underneath, and they were saying, we don't know what happened. They had to stay for the period of 3 days with not being able to communicate, not knowing, just entire humiliation.
This is at the birth of our Lord.
This was
at the announcement.
The annunciation. After she said yes. When she said yes to the angel, that's what happened. And the angel, of course, took her answer to God.
Well, this is something extremely high. This yes of Our Lady's, I did not know, have notion of it, was something about the effects it produced in hell. But then, like you said, it was a battle cry of enthusiasm for God, because the word enthusiasm in Greek, it comes from this. It's to be full of God. It's to be filled with God. And Our Lady was enthused in that moment. I mean, she was filled with God, and she was enthused for God, and she was enthused for her virginity. She was enthused for her slavery towards God. And of course, in a certain sense, it seems something almost like a star, a man, all of us here, tiny human beings, like small ants contemplating in the starry sky. Wow, that's beautiful, but it's like far away from us. But then as slaves of Our Lady, we have a participation in this. In the measure that we give ourselves entirely to Our Lady, St. Louis says this, when we give ourselves to Our Lady, she gives herself to us. So in the measure that we give the little that we have, the nothing that we have to her, we have a participation before God in this triumph of Our Lady. In fact, theologically, St. Thomas, centuries before St. Louis, said this, that in that moment, when God, then the angel Gabriel appeared before Our Lady, representing God, and offered to her for her to be the mother of God, for Jesus to come to this earth. In that moment, historically, God was not just asking her permission to be the mother of God. God was asking her permission for the work of redemption. Because if she would never do this. But by some absurd, she had said, no, there would not be redemption. Our Lord would not have saved us. So in that moment, St. Thomas Aquinas teaches that the whole of humanity was represented in one single human being. The yes she said was not a yes for her. It was a yes for every human being from Adam right to the last one which will exist. And all of us in that moment were being asked by God, do you accept to be saved? I want to incarnate. I want to save you. I want to die for you. I want to love you. Will you say yes? Our Lady, when she said yes for all of us from Adam till the last one of us. So all of us participated in her enthusiasm, in her virginity at that moment. We just have to accept this participation. She's willing to give this to us, but then it depends on us as slaves, much more so than others as slaves. In saying yes to being assumed by Our Lady, like she was enthused, she was full of God, we have to be enthused with Our Lady. We have to be full of Our Lady to participate in this.
Mm-hmm. And that's why enthusiasm is like a gust of wind. It takes people with them. It drags them along because she's the model. She's the role model for all men and women and virgins or mothers. She's the role model for all. But in above all, that's why in the passage, I believe it's St. Luke, when someone praises the Blessed Virgin Mary, he's preaching, Jesus, our Lord, is preaching in a house, and there's so many people around. They say, listen, and then someone in the multitude cries out and says, blessed are you, the mother. Yeah. The mother of Jesus, for you gave birth to the mm-hmm. to the Messiah, to the and then he says, greater and much more blessed are those who do
hear the will of my Father and put it into practice.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Fulfill the will of my Father and practice the will of God. And so deep down, Jesus was praising Our Lady,
yeah,
because she was the one who had done the will of God most perfectly. But even she was more praised for doing the will of God, yeah, and giving birth to the will of God on earth. She was the first one, therefore, to give birth as a virgin to the will of God, and then followed giving birth to the God incarnate.
Yeah, very impressive. That's really beautiful. Because this aspect of Our Lady, Father, of her, this what she did, this fact you mentioned now of her giving birth to the will of God, and what you mentioned earlier about her fact when she goes up to the room, when she sees, but then, you see, virginity is something which normally is opposed to maternity, or to paternity for that matter. Because somebody who's married, has children, stops being a virgin, has children, so to speak, has offspring and multiplies himself in a certain way. Virginity is a case where the person does not have a continuity on this earth. He won't have children. But then Our Lady is the greatest proof that when the person is virgin, he has much more offspring and he produces much more effect upon others. He does much more, produce a bigger difference being a virgin and, so to speak, being close in oneself than would do by being a physical mother or a father, of course, which is not something despisable.
No, in no way.
It's something extremely elevated.
But that's a difficulty too, because someone can ask, I don't know if Brother Morgan has an idea about that, but someone could say, well, I'm a married person, so the virginity of Our Lady doesn't speak too much to me. That doesn't mean too much. Or how can I imitate Our Lady in that sense? And there's a way of doing it, of being, although being a mother or being a father, to be a virgin as well in a certain sense. And that would be in the virginality, therefore the identity of will with God. Because if the person is called to the married state and they feel in that calling perfect will of God, then they're in some way living virginality, let's say, mm-hmm, which is the virginity of the spirit, being married. And of course, having Our Lady as a model, because she is also
a mother.
She's a married person. She has a husband, Saint Joseph. What is that? The mother of Saint Teresa of the Child Jesus. Mm-hmm. She said she had two very interesting things, and of course she was a slave. In the sense that she wanted to do the will of God, especially in raising her children. And she said, I raise my children to heaven. And always when she had a child, the first thing she would say, God, if this child not be yours, take it now.
Wow. Impressive. For a mother to have the courage to say that.
Yes, that was her prayer.
It's because she had such a love for her children.
And she had five girls. Wow. And I think the two boys, or two or three, at least two, they didn't survive. But they're in heaven.
Wow.
So she raised all of her children to heaven. And that's being used, that's being wanting to be Mary, Our Lady.
In the marriage
mother,
state.
And wanting to be, have that spirit of integrity, of righteousness. And of course, respecting the married life, and many times for those who are in the married state, when they use that which is their gift of life, always in the sense that God wants it, they also live in a certain way, imitating the Blessed Virgin Mary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. In fact, Monsieur Jean has mentioned a number of times that there are people who may not have lost their virginity physically due to X, Y, Z reasons, because of some circumstances, but in their soul, such is a desire for them, their intemperance, a desire to sin, their desire in their soul, that they don't have the virginality of the soul, in spite of the fact that they may physically, in just like you said, it's much more important. Our Lady was more pleasing to God by doing His will than being His mother. Just like that, we can be more virginal in spite of the fact that the person be married and has children, can be more virginal. Somebody who may physically be a virgin but does not have virginality of the soul. The parallel, I think, is perfect here between Our Lady's state and any one of us. And as slaves of Our Lady, some of us are called to live, to imitate her virginity of body. All of us are called to imitate, to live her virginity of soul. And then it's a... She always, the best part is virginity of the body, you can lose it once and you can get it back. Virginity of the soul, Our Lady is always offering at us every moment. You lost it, she's again there. No, I'm going to give it back to you, my son. Raise up, get up, let's go forward. At every moment, she's there to give it back, raise us up.
And very interestingly, something that we didn't mention at the beginning, but Our Lady is the only person who has as her proper name, Virgin, right? Virgin Mary, or Mary Virgin. Yeah. So that she's incorporated into her name. And of course, from early Christianity, the Christians believed that she was Mary, ever Virgin.
Yeah. This ever virgin, perpetual virgin, is something beautiful, because I guess many of those who are watching us now may not know it, but why is she called a perpetual virgin? They say her virginity has three phases, so to speak. She was a virgin before birth, at her conception, the first miracle of being a virgin. Of course, all of us know that it was a miracle. But during birth, at the moment that our Lord Jesus Christ came out of her womb, He preserved her virginity. And the theology says that He assumed a glorious body, because after dying, all of us will have glorious bodies. Our Lord did not have it because he could have had one right from his birth, but He chose to live a body similar to the one that we live, a body of sin. But at the moment of His birth, He had a glorious body, so that He could come out of Our Lady's body without touching her, without breaking the integrity of her virginity. Because a glorious body can pass through walls, like Jesus passed through the walls to come to the apostles. And He passed through the walls of Our Lady's body to come out. And so He preserved a virginity in the second phase, during birth. And then again, of course, after this, the third phase for all eternity, for the rest of her life, she remained a virgin. And in heaven, she continues a virgin. I mean, that was weird to talk about. I guess it would be incomplete if when we're talking about the virginity of Faridi, if we don't at least mention Saint Joseph. But Saint Joseph was put by our Lord, was put chosen by God to be another virgin, always virgin, but also to be a guardian of the virginity of Our Lady. It was his role to guarantee that Our Lady would always be able to remain a virgin because of his integrity, and also he would protect her from anything else, anybody else who would try to. So again, like we said, when we talk about people who have difficulty practicing chastity, we pray to Our Lady, we admire the virginity, the purity of Our Lady, but then again, we can also always ask, we ought to ask Saint Joseph to defend us from the snares of the devil, like he did to Our Lady. I don't know if...
Maybe, Brother John, before we go into St. Joseph, I'd like to make an objection.
Yes, sir, please.
It's actually not a personal objection. It's actually an objection that many people have raised throughout history.
Uh-huh.
And I'm sure Father David has a good response to this objection that has been raised so many times. And the objection is the following. In the Gospel, the evangelist tell us that our Lord had brothers and sisters. And so how do you explain that after the birth of our Lord, Our Lady continued being a virgin, if it says in the Gospel that our Lord Jesus Christ had brothers and sisters? Of course, we know that this is not the case, but this is an objection that has been...
I'm sure people have heard this.
Many times given
in history. Let me help you, Brother Morgan. There's one more objection.
Even Protestants bring that up too.
One more objection is the fact what they say that Our Lady was remained the virgin. She did not know any man till she gave birth to our Lord. She remained a virgin till she gave birth. So if she remained till then, it's a sign that afterwards she did not. I mean, that's another stupid objection that people raise up. So Father, please.
Well, I think that you could, that's not that hard, because if you know a little bit of the Bible and, of course,
terminology
of the Bible, you take in other places in which it says in the Bible, for instance, that Abraham had a brother called Lot, and when he was actually his nephew. And that's why close relatives, many times they call brothers and sisters. In other circumstances in the Bible, that happens as well. They refer as brothers and sisters, those who are actually only relatives.
David and Jonathan, they had no relation whatsoever, but they called each other brothers.
Exactly. In many circumstances, our Lord Jesus Christ also said, "Go tell my brothers." And it was all the apostles. So right. We can't think now.
All of them are born from Ali.
Exactly. That St. Peter and St. John was who was a cousin of our Lord, that they were actually born of Our Lady. That's nonsense.
So in other words?
But I think in that objection, there's something which is deeper. There's something which is deeper, and which is to challenge the mind of God, to challenge God in that he would want something which was more perfect for his mother.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think there's like a ill will.
Have a right to have his mother.
Exactly. He could have making exceptions. Yeah. And God, he has his own rules. Those who try to prove the contrary want to make their rules.
Yeah.
But I think it's better to follow God's rules.
Also, if Father...
Exactly.
Who God did something... I mean, God could have let Our Lady become a mother. It was necessary for Our Lady to have Our Lord, I mean, for the whole of redemption. It was something which had to be done. So something that was necessary, God was such a big miracle for Our Lord to be born, as something which is the only case in all of history. And then it doesn't make sense, because right after that, when it was no longer necessary for Our Lady to have other children, that which was preserved with so much love by God, he gives it up without any reason.
Exactly. Hey. And St. Ildefons, very interesting, St. Ildefons, he even inculpates those who he has as heretics in his mind. He says, how can you stain with a human union that which God made it as a divine union?
No, it's impossible. Exactly. But it's like you said, it's like people who want to challenge God's plans, because they think that their plans are better. I don't know, or that God doesn't, like, as if God didn't know what he was doing.
Yeah.
When, well, first he created the universe. If I was God,
I would not have done it like that.
From nothing, he created everything that exists.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it's, and you're going to contest God because you're going to say he doesn't. It's kind of, you know, it's exactly what you said, Father. There's a something deeper behind. You know, one time, Monsignor Juan, our founder, he gave a metaphor on how we try to understand divine things and even the angelic spirits and the way the Holy Trinity acts and, first, so to say, in human terms, thinks and decides things. We know that obviously God is a... And he said it's more or less, it's kind of like a dog who is at home, and every morning he sees his owner coming and turning on the water. So he has to do all, like, has to turn the knob and this and that, and then the water runs. And then he takes a pot out of, he opens up this wooden thing, and he takes out a metal bowl, and he puts it under the water. And then he does this, then he puts it onto the metal thing that looks kind of like a rack, like a shelf, and fire starts coming up. And then afterwards, he takes this yellow liquid, after it becomes dirty with food and everything, he takes a yellow liquid and he starts cleaning it with a sponge, and then he puts it away. And the dog thinks to himself, well, why doesn't he just leave it on the stove? He doesn't understand that each day you have to clean the pots and pans, you have to prepare the food. The
dog's food is always over there. I mean, he sees, he doesn't know how every day he comes, his pot is full of food, the water comes over there, he doesn't understand why or how.
And then his owner goes to work and he takes this metal weird looking thing with a lot of like notches on it, and he puts it into the hole in the door, and he turns it, and then he opens it, and then he goes around and he does the same thing on the other side. Well, why don't you just leave the door open? But it's because the dog doesn't know that there exist thieves, that you have to lock your doors at night, that this and that, and that's called a key, that's called a doorknob. It's kind of like us trying to understand the way that God.
So basically it's saying, don't be a dog.
Exactly.
Well, dogs may be, in some cases, they may be more clever than people who defy God's plans.
Yeah, unfortunately. I mean, the solution here is to admire. And not everything can be imitated by us. Like virginity, you can't imitate always. If you're married, you can't. Or if you lost your virginity, you can't. Not everything can be understood. There are so many things that God does in the Bible that till today, nobody really understands. That you find the most varied interpretations, and you find theologians saying that this is difficult to understand. For example, the book of the Apocalypse, there are so many things, the book of Revelations, that everyone knows that there is no definite interpretation till today. So things which you don't understand. But what we can always do in every moment is to admire. Even I can't imitate, I can't understand, admire I always can. I can always enchant myself with Our Lady, with her virginity, I can always enthuse myself. I mean, I think that's something.
There's something beautiful in that regard. A phrase of Professor Plinio Correa de Oliveira, he once said that before that which God reveals, many times we can understand. We could go into the thoughts of God, the will of God, but he said we should try to understand as much as we can. We should try to sink deep into that which is the will of God, His plans. But after we enter, when we don't understand anymore, what do we have to do? Kneel down, admire, and adore.
Yeah.
Because there are some things which are mysteries.
Yeah. Some things which are beyond our intellect, some things which are beyond our will, some things which are beyond. But admire, adore, enthuse ourselves. That's beautiful, Father. Father, it's nearly time for us to finish. And we've been talking about all sort of aspects related to Our Lady, our virginity, about our chastity, etc. But before we finish now, Father, would you have any advice for all those who are watching us now? In regards to this point, in regards to the practice of chastity, for us to be more similar to Our Lady, in this specific point of the purity of body and soul, would you have any advice that you'd like to give everybody who's watching us now?
I believe that, first of all, we have to understand that each one of us is called to a state, and in order to be too comfortable or to be at ease with the the state that God has called us to, we have to discern, we have to pray. And so the first counsel suggestion is that we pray to our guardian angel, because our guardian angel, he has a mission of aiding us and complimenting us, and he wants to be, he already won, he was already victorious, and he was victorious against the impure spirits, the evil spirits. And so therefore, he's already confirmed, let's say, in the will of God, and he wants to confirm us in the will of God. If someone has true devotion, not only to the Blessed Virgin Mary and as a slave of Our Lady, but ask their guardian angel, their personal guardian angel, and also the angels that God wills that be aided and helped by them, he will start making the war much easier in the practice of chastity. That's definite. And another thing is, when a person, we have our gaze, our eyes are the windows of our soul, right? When I look at something, I have the willpower, I have the capacity of taking my eyes off of that. Therefore, I don't have something, I can go like this, close my hand, right, immediately. When I look at something, I can close my eyes, yeah. Right? But now the eyes of my heart. How do I close the eyes of my heart? You know how you do that? Practice. Practice makes perfect. Practice. But above all, you have to admire a lot that which is beautiful, that which is marvelous. I remember when Dr. Plinio was a boy, he said that he had many sessions, study sessions in the school, St. Louis School in São Paulo, Brazil. And many times he would watch the crows flying way up in the blue sky. And he thought, flying up in the blue sky? He said, I would like to fly one day in the blue sky. How many people, how many children didn't think of flying in the blue sky? He said, but in order for that crow to fly that high, he probably has to want, have a great desire to go up. And when he has to fly off the tree, that must take a lot of effort. So he has to, in order to make that effort, he has to want to reach that apex. So if we admire, if we have a spirit of marvelous, therefore of things that enchant us, and above all desire to live to in heaven with the angels and saints, who are all like Our Lady, or similar to Our Lady, at least in one or another aspect, then we have to have a great desire to be good, to be chaste, to be immaculate, to be virgin or virgin-like in our state. And that's, we have to have that desire. And another thing is, when something which is contrary to the practice of chastity, we have to be very strong and adamant, closing our souls. We have to practice that, because the angels, the good angels in heaven, maintain heaven clean and immaculate because they were absolutely the good angels in heaven kept the area, clean, because they were quick in their answer. They were like lightning quick.
They did not let the heaven be stained by the sin.
They didn't let heaven be stained by the sin, because it was an immediate reaction. So our reaction towards temptation or the solicitations of the flesh, as we promised in our baptism, must be immediate. And that's what Our Lady gives us to the slaves, that we must be immediate in saying yes to God.
Thank you, Father. That was very beautiful.
I think then, the title for our podcast could maybe be The Battle Cry of Virginity.
Ah, that's nice. Then Nimesh and I note that down so we don't forget this. The Battle Cry of Virginity. I like that. Brother, Father, can you give us a final blessing now for us to end?
The intercession of Mary, ever Virgin, may the blessing of Almighty God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Amen.
Salve Maria.
Salve Maria.
Salve Maria.
If you like this video, press the like button and leave a comment below. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel and activate the notification bell so you won't miss any of our videos.